So first of all, I'm going to turn to Will, if I may, to react to Simon's very provocative, I suppose, speech to us. Will, what do you think of it?
Well, I was expecting to come and slightly pick a fight, but you end up picking a sort of violent agreement, really. I think I don't think you can argue with much of what Simon's saying. I think there's just 10% that I would. It's you do have a really forward-looking DCMS strategy for sport that's all based on five well-being outcomes that you more or less outlined.
2015 strategy.
Yeah, 2015. Yeah. Physical health, mental health, all of these are... And in sport now, we are sort of almost running the National Preventative Health Service. But being asked to do that on 100th of the budget, as you pointed out, health budget is 120 billion, the education budget, another good target, 85 billion, DCMS, 1.5 billion. And I think the only bit that I sort of almost argue against, really, is that there's lots of great ammunition, but picking elite sport or the performance of Team GB is perhaps the wrong target. Because if you look at another area of economics, which behavioural insights or behavioural economics, however you want to boil it down, you've got two elements to that, really, and this is very crude, but you have the salience and priming and awareness, the profile, which is why you see Sport England's lottery This Girl Can campaign. Huge campaign. Everywhere on 48 sheets, you've probably not been able to get away from it. That's about putting sport in the front of people's minds and trying to get them to do it. And behavioural science would say the next thing you need is something called EAST, which is something that's easy, attractive, social and timely to do. So those are both, you know, very UK sports behavioural insights all over the world. Now, what you're thinking is, I really wish somebody would have done that last summer and just proved that it's not either elite sport and grassroots. It's not either or, it's both together. And if you combine them both together, you do get really good outcomes. So I Am Team GB was... Team GB returned from Rio triumphant, and then there was 2,600 grassroots events up and down the country in sports clubs. About 1 million people turned up, 52% of them not massively regular sports players. The big question everyone goes is, yeah, but it was just the same old middle-class white guys nobody knew. So Parkrun, Nick's here somewhere, Parkrun have data on absolutely everything. And they had 6% of new runners that weekend, incredibly consistent with the poll that you did that said the Olympics inspires 7% of the population to do sports. So that's 7% of people doing a new sport. And The Guardian wrote it up as only 7%. 7% is 3 million people. That's a lot of people. Now, at Jump, I worked with Daniel Fujiwara, who did 2014 qualifying and valuing the well-being impacts of sport. On average, it's £1,127 a year for somebody to play sport. Team sports are better than individual sports. Team sports are, you get all the benefits of communication. The gym is arguably bad for you. And that £1,000 is quite interesting because the physical benefits of health benefits and savings to the NHS is only 10% of the benefits. The rest of it is all in the mental health, the community and the social interactions. So this is 7%, 3 million people turning up, playing a new sport in their community worth about £1,000 a time. That's £3 billion. So your return on investment for taking elite sport and measuring it and putting it together in behavioural science best practice, I suppose, gives you a return on investment in economics potentially of about £3 billion on an investment in UK sport of 300 million. So potentially a return of 10 to 1. So those sorts of things, it seems we suffer in sport sometimes with the, and I'm looking at this, we're in the Coliseum, aren't we? And life of Brian. And there'll be people up there going, Judean people's front versus the people's front of Judea. You know, splitters, You know, it's ridiculous. If you combine the profile, the awareness of all the BBC coverage of the Olympics with a good grassroots campaign where everyone can go down to it, you get phenomenally good outcomes with incredible returns on investment. We're just picking the wrong targets. Simon's picked the right targets. It's transport budgets. Let's get more off them for cycling. It's the 120 billion on the health budgets for sports. A fantastic product. Every type of it is a fantastic product. We should just make a clear, consistent, concerted business case that it all works together and go for those budgets. Go for those budgets. Stop sort of having this, oh, let's all argue that we should have money off the Olympians, who are doing, quite frankly, looks like a pretty good job to me. And if you ask people, there's another point on how you measure the pride that you get from winning the Olympics. So there's another way of measuring this, and it was done in Canada, and it's endorsed by the government's Green Book on Policy Evaluation. It's called Willingness to Pay. And they ask Canadians, what would you pay to see your team, to Team Canada, top of the medal table? Between $45 to $90. So let's do a survey like that. Let's ask them. Because if you did that in the UK, if you ask people what they're proud of about the UK, it's NHS, Royal Family, not the TV programme, it's NHS, the Army, and Team GB. So if we're willing to pay the same as Canadians, that's going to total up to about 1.25 billion. Again, four times more than we're actually spending. So I think there's loads of ways of looking at this economically, but let's not go, it's either this or this. Let's put them together and go for, as you quite rightly say, make the case for extra transport, extra health budgets going into the National Preventative Health Service.
So, Will, I like your strategy of having cake and eating it too. But good luck with arguing that money should come out of the health budget at the moment to go into sport. And if I push you and say there's only the pot of money that's there, would you choose medals or facilities around the country? Which would you go for?
Medals or facilities around the country?
Because that is the choice, I think.
Well, I think sometimes people are creating this. It's an artificial choice, I think. I wouldn't have either of them. I'd go, let's have a sugar tax. You know, why are we doing this? Why are we? Everyone's picking everybody else in sport, and over here is a massive issue of sugar. Let's have a sugar tax and dedicate the whole thing to sport. I know the Treasury can't do that and they hate it. But the answer is no. Tax on Coca-Cola.
We might come back to that. Let me turn now to Mark.
Okay, thank you. So I spend more time and money on both elite sports and grassroots sports than makes sense, although, and I will fall into Simon's trap here, but if you sat in the away end, as I did at White Hart Lane yesterday, the link between elite sport and Stoke City was hard to kind of find for 90 minutes. But grassroots-wise, I've spent 15 years coaching my sons and daughter at various sports. So I do sit across the two, and I guess because of that, I think the two do work together, but maybe in a wider context than just Will was talking about there. You know, I would say that the elite sport, the inspiration part is really important, but at EY, we've just hired 9 female Paralympians and Olympians, and one of the reasons is we think we can learn from them, but also we think there is a fertile path of taking people from sport into business, but there's clearly some part of trying to inspire and build our diversity agenda there with successful women in one walk of life. So I think that is another piece. And sport really, I think, does add not just to the health, but the well-being and the ability to influence education and other economic outcomes. And I would say there, the Premier League has a brand that allows you to get to kids that other people can't get to. And, you know, I am a white working class boy, and I recognise when we go with the Premier League to Liverpool, we actually do get to people in a slightly different way. So I think we shouldn't neglect elite sport for some of the other things it might be able to do there. Equally on the grassroots side, let's not romanticise all of the grassroots. And like Simon, I played football and cricket in the 80s. In fact, I still sadly play football now, and in my grassroots 40 and 60-year-old games on Saturday, a former advisor to Tony Blair headbutted a 50-year-old CEO of a recruitment company. And so grassroots sports has its sort of downsides as well. But for me, I love team sports, and I take Will's point about the well-being benefits there, the kind of being part of a team. Equally, my daughter who plays hockey, she and a lot of her friends really like swimming, keep fit, dance as other ways of sport. So I don't think we should just think about facilities in the team sports centre. I think there are ways of other ways we might engage people in sport. And then for me, the key bit becomes coaching. And I remember at the time, it didn't mean very much to me, but my school games teacher said to me, my job is to keep you playing sport for as long as I can in your life. And he's done that. You know, if he came and watched my football on Saturday, he may argue it isn't sport. But I think, you know, that driving participation over a long period of time is part of it. But you do need good coaches for that. Yes, we can all play street football, and I've certainly done that. But to keep people going, I think you do need to get better. You do need to have people to encourage you. So a bit like with our PPI hospitals, if we don't have money to fund the operating costs and the doctors on an ongoing basis, then we risk making redundant facilities. So for me, you know, both sides come together. I'm not here as an advocate for the Premier League, but some of the things the Premier League does, and it has more money than most people to do these things, but it does run community programs, but it also does things like Premier League Kicks, where it gets into helping kids in difficult areas not just do sport but talk about their personal development. It actually funds coaches in schools across 12 Olympic sports, so not just football, it very much trying to do other things with those resources. So for me, if you can harness elite sport, put it together with grassroots sport, you have a chance of making a difference, not just about health and well-being, but also about educational outcomes, maybe economic outcomes over time, and communities. One just slightly random thought on the funding debate. In 2013-14, Premiership footballers paid £891 million in income tax, which you can go away afterwards and think, well, there's 500 of them, 25 in 20 clubs and the squads. Rate of tax is about 45%. You can work out what their gross pay might be if so inclined. But I think this year that tax bill might be £1.2 billion. If you look at where the transfer market has gone over that period, you know, maybe a 20% levy on that tax take would be one way of putting some more money into sport. But that's sort of just off the back of my envelope.
We've got two new taxes already.
Yeah.
Mark, can you just say a little bit more about the links between the Premier League and the great mass of people playing football? I mean, this is one of the points Simon made, yep, that there's not that channel for people to start kicking around at school and yep, then progress into the Premier League.
So Premier League clearly has a set of its resources to driving the Premier League and interest in the Premier League and trying to bring players through in that system. But it does also support these other initiatives. So last year, I think 2015, 555,000 school kids were participated in Premier League programmes. So there is there, and that's not just about football. That's very much, as I said, things like kicks, like the Premier League Enterprise Challenge, where there's a business competition for schools. Stoke City, and I'm sorry to talk about it again, but they run two things, for example. So Eurofit is a programme for 40 to 65-year-old men to lose weight. And the way that Stoke do it is they run it at the training ground. So you go and change where the players train, you use the facilities. They have almost no dropouts in that 12-week programme. So that's kind of an innovative way of using things. And they also have the challenge, which is where they go to schools and actually so work with kids who look to as if they're going to drop out of education, not going to have employment, and really try and work with them over a period of time to mentor them in. So there is a football side, but I think there's a wider side as well there.
Tanni, my experience of sport was sitting at the side of the cricket pitch when my dad played Lancashire League, which gave me a bit of an aversion to it. So I'm a little bit in awe of your expertise. But can you tell us what your take is on Simon's charge of upside-downness?
I probably feel I should explain some of my interest in sports. I was a Paralympian. I'm chair of UK Active. I'm a mum to a 15-year-old on a talent pathway, which is a really interesting process. Possibly most importantly, I'm Welsh. And in true Trump spirit, I'm going to declare the rugby result at the weekend fake. And by tomorrow, we might have won. But I mean, elite sport, I think, is incredibly important. And I don't want us ever to go back to 96, where the Olympic team had a disaster. Everyone forgets the Paralympic team did really well. And lottery funding came in. And, Olympic sport inspired me to become a Paralympian. Chris Hallam winning the London Marathon inspired me to go off and do wheelchair racing as a sport. But I think you have to look at that correlation. So, you know, I spent 20 years of my life ultimately training for 19 and a half minutes on the track to win the medals I did. That's not what most people want to do, or, you know, find that something that's particularly exciting or attractive to do. But I think we have to remember what elite success gives us. So it inspires lots of people to try different things. It's good for the UK economy. It's good for UK PLC in terms of us being on a world stage. And I don't think we can forget, you know, UK sport remit was to win gold medals. It wasn't to change the health of a nation. That's other bodies within the British system. If I look to 2012, and we talked a lot about legacy, actually some of the biggest legacy of 2012 was about integration of Paralympic sport and really pushing that forward. So in that way, great sporting moments are amazing in terms of that sort of flashpoint to get people to think differently about themselves. For me, my biggest aim for 2012 was to have lots of people being not very good at sport. And when I say that, people jump back. And because actually, we say sport when we mean physical activity, physical literacy, community sport, elite sport. We say sport and we use it as a catch-all phrase. And I think we have to be better at defining what we mean by different levels of participation. And I think if you look at the question that was asked through the survey, I mean, the way you ask the question delivers lots of different results. The question I was most frequently asked by journalists when I became a mum was, which is the most important thing in your life, your medals or your child? Oh, my medals. You know, so... and it varies, to be honest, depending what mood you're in. So, you know, absolutely sport can change people's lives. I've seen it firsthand in this country. I've seen it in Rwanda, Palestine, Israel, all around the world. Nelson Mandela said sport has the power to change the world. Far be it from me to change Nelson Mandela's quote, but I think it should be physical activity has the power to change the world. But it's about having opportunity. And we've got some really big challenging times at the moment. We're in austerity. I work on welfare reform and legal aid, and we're going to be in austerity for a long time. But we have to be smarter about how we use physical activity, whether it's for the aging population, social care, being smarter, actually real joined-up government. I mean, that's my one aspiration, is trying to get us to think really differently about how we use this really, really powerful tool. You know, inactivity costs us £20 billion a year. 37,000 people die every year because of inactivity. But the leisure industry is at least a £7 billion business. But that's slightly disconnected from what we think of as sport. So we need to be just much smarter. We're a nation that loves watching sport, but we need to be a nation that loves doing sport and physical activity. So should we invest in elite sport? Yes, absolutely. But should we harness the power of physical activity? We need to be much, much better at doing that. And I think what we are much better at doing in sort of the last cycle is measuring what people do and understanding that you dip in and out and it changes through a million different things that impacts on people's lives. But if there was three things I could change right now, if I had a magic wand, it would be really simple. It would be kids' activity. You know, there is a sugar tax. It's going to go into the school sport premium. If I could change that a bit, I'd have it in looking at the wider school day, what children do inside and outside school, how they get to school. It's a national disgrace that children's activity levels drop through the summer holidays and that they go back to school in September less fit and healthy than they were when they left in July. So let's open up school facilities. Let's be smart about how we do that. We need to look at workplace health. People are literally dying in work. And if people aren't more active, that's only going to get worse. And the final thing I'd do was look differently about capital expenditure. And as chair of UK Active, we're talking about how we can get wellbeing hubs, about GP surgeries along with libraries, police stations, getting local authorities to think differently about the facilities they provide. So a GP doesn't just tell you to go and walk more, but actually can show you what to do. You know, I can sit in 20 minutes and write a four-year training program for somebody who wants to be a Paralympian. To get someone who's inactive to find the right thing for them to do takes expertise. And not only do we not support teachers in primary schools in terms of teaching PE, GPs aren't taught how to deliver physical activity or how to prescribe physical activity. So we need to look at that. And, you know, what actually is really exciting about tonight is that I don't think I've ever been involved in a debate which is even talking about elite sport or activity, or but the fact that we're actually thinking about it in a different way, I think is massively positive, because I think we can have our cake and eat it. We just have to be smart about how much money we've got and be really creative about it. And, you know, if we want a sport in future, we have to harness that creativity.
So you made a really interesting point about being clear about what it is we're aiming for. Is it economic growth, saving money? Is it about medals? Is it about health and well-being? So do you think we're getting these things muddled up a bit in the way we're talking about it?
I think what happens is every 4 years the Olympics and Paralympics gets massive profile, and we all get very excited about it, and then we forget, you know, people going out and being physically active doesn't get much column inches in the newspaper, it doesn't get an awful lot of TV coverage. There's lots of really amazing things happening out there, but it's just not in front of us all the time. And I think that's where, you know, in terms of how we use our elite athletes to talk about more than just their career in sport, I think is really important. But, you know, it's got to start at the youngest age possible. People have to take more personal responsibility for being active, rather than just waiting for something to be done to them or waiting for them to be shown a programme. But you know what, that actually starts, you know, it's great. I'm really pleased Sport England now dropped the age to 5, but in terms of what they're able to look at and the different creativity that they're going to be allowed in terms of their budgets. But actually, we need to be looking as soon as children are born. We know if a child learns to catch a ball at 2 years old, their maths and English are better because of the... If you try to imagine the complicated mathematical formula for the trajectory of a ball, and you teach a two-year-old to catch a ball, you're joining up the synapses in the brain. We know there is so much research out there that shows physical activity changes lives. We just need to do it. We need to give parents, mums, dads some of those skills to do it.
Thank you. Simon, you've been listening to those reactions. You get some comeback before we go to the audience.
You do, in the end, have to make choices. I mean, this is a pound coin. Where we don't have unlimited numbers of them, and we're not going to divert more of them to sport. Where are you going to spend it? Are you going to give it to somebody who can win a medal? We spend about £5.5 million per medal at the Olympics. Or are you going to give it to somebody who is never going to win any sporting trophy in their whole lives, but if they have a kick-around pitch next to their house, they will be happier, healthier, and more connected forever? And I would always say, let's do the second option. In the end, you very often have to choose. I know the Premier League does some good things. I know elite sport does inspire some people. I know it's nice when people from your country win a medal, but we have just got completely out of whack. And I've got nothing against Olympians. I've got nothing against Premier League footballers. I admire them. We should not be giving them that much of the incredibly scarce funding that's allotted. It's just wrong.
Well, we know where you stand. So I'm going to turn to the audience now. I want to ask Andrew about how Street Soccer Academy goes about getting people to take part in physical activity. And when you... do put your hand up later. Please wait for the microphone to come to you. Andrew, tell us what you do.
Thank you. I'd just like to thank Pro Bono Economics and Regenerous Consulting for the piece of impact reporting that was conducted. I know Jamal's here tonight, so thank you very much. I represent a charity based in the northwest of England called Street Soccer Academy, and we use sport, predominantly football and fitness-based programmes, to reach out to hard-to-reach communities in the northwest of England particularly. And we found that being able to use the strength of a hook like football, where the role of the sports coach still holds such a highly respected position in the lives of young people and people of all ages, that you get uniquely positioned to influence individuals who have multiple and complex needs. So we support homeless people, those with offending issues, addiction-based issues, dysfunctional families, that type of demographic group. You know, we can make all the claims in the world of low reoffending rates, of increased health and well-being, of reaching out to individuals in dark places where other sports and mechanisms perhaps don't reach. We can get homeless people off the street and get them engaged with sport. All these marvellous things, but until someone independently analyses and provides you with an evidence base that what you do works, you're limited in terms of how much attention you get, how much investment you can receive. And this type of reporting has really enabled us to prove what we do and other charities and organisations does work. I find the discussion tonight quite compelling and interesting because we take great inspiration from elite athletes and successes that we do have, particularly in the Olympics, not so much with the football as such, but what we do find the football does do is allow us to use the not so great examples sometimes that are portrayed in the media to teach life lessons to individuals that we work with and enable an open door to discuss truly what is going on in someone's life rather than making it quite threatening and homing in on a specific issue and making it personal. So that does help. But nevertheless, football and sport generally at an elite level does inspire and give aspirational aims and objectives to the individuals that we work on behalf of. So for them, it isn't to become a professional athlete as such, but it is to rectify their relationships. It is to get employed. It is to no longer reoffend. And we find that there's definitely a balancing act. Yes, we have to work hard for funding, but we need to think innovatively as to how we find that funding and not be overtly focused on just government funding. Do we receive government funding? No. Have we been able to prove our worth to a degree? Yes. So Pro Bono Economics Report stated that for every £1 invested into our organisation, we're able to have a social dividend of £10. So a 200k-based organisation having a £2 million economical worth. These are really useful statistics and information for us to present quite a compelling case for investment, not just to the government, but society generally, sponsorship from businesses, donors, supporters. And I find it a challenge not just to say, okay, investment into sport, how much should go into elite sport? Is there a disparity with how much goes into grassroots sport? But more a case of how do we need to look at funding streams? How diverse can we make them so that whether we get a proportion from government, proportion from specified sports-based funds or health and wellbeing, that actually we've got a good plethora of income streams.
So you're also saying to me we need to find some more money. If it's not going to come from government, it's got to come from somewhere
Absolutely.
Else.
I don't think we should be reliant on government.
Okay. Now, somebody else, if she's here, is Catherine Morley. Is Catherine here before I open it up? Can you tell us something about how you get young people to actually do things, to put down the iPhone or the smartphone and get up and do something?
Yeah. I'm from Onside Youth Zones. We create massive facilities, the sorts of facilities that Simon was really pleased to see. The facilities themselves aren't going to get people active. It's a good first base, but it's literally just first base. And thinking back to the 40s and 50s, I mean, they really only had one channel, I think, on telly. Whereas now we're up against, everybody's iPhone. And for the boys in particular, the Xboxes and PlayStations are an absolute disaster in terms of getting boys active. what we try to do is reduce all of the barriers to participation to as low as possible, remove them completely. So it's not just about providing spaces and facilities to do things, it's also then removing those other barriers around feeling awkward, the sorts of things as adults that we don't generally talk about worrying that you aren't going to be any good compared to everybody else. Are you going to have fun? Are you going to be made to do something you don't want to do? So through the relationships that we build up, the staff with young people who come to our centres, and the even the design of the building, the amount of glass that we have, so that young people can see activities, they don't have to get involved until they've sort of really clocked it and understand what it is that the others are doing. Facilities, yes, great. Relationships, really important. And being able to see that it's not just, for young people, it isn't necessarily at all about the physical activity. It's about being part of something with their friends. And so making it social, being a really important social point.
And what about elite role models?
Yeah, it's fantastic. When we do get sportsmen and women to come to the youth zones, it's absolutely wonderful for young people. But it's quite a long leap for them for what they're doing compared to what they're seeing. So important, but yeah, no, probably more about a youth worker or a sports worker who they really like. Yeah. And they just think, yeah, I'll have a go. Yeah.
Okay, let me turn to the audience now. And so tell us a little bit about who you are and Feel free to ask questions, which we might save up if they're questions, or just give us your views about this debate. So who wants to put their hand up first?
Are medals worthless, do you think, then?
Will?
Well, no. But no, it's... So we're all comfortable with the concept of... You'll hear it on the Today programme. Every time a budget comes out, consumer confidence. And that consumer confidence, everyone's heard about that. The market economy recognise it. It's all about how we feel comfortable to spend money we don't have on crap we don't really need. That's the value of the confidence. Now, if I mentioned the Canadian study and the pride and the well-being that people get from us being top of the medal table. We love it. We watch it on the television. It makes us feel good. It's not the whole picture. But if you value that, how people feel is really fundamental to how they behave and how the economy then goes on to structure itself. It's part of it. And it's not like, you know, Simon's question of, you've got £1. Okay, well, I'd spend probably the equivalent of what we do actually spend, which is about maybe 5 to 10p on the inspiration and getting people to do it. The rest of it goes into really good execution.
It's a lot more than that. It's 345 million quid over the next Tokyo cycle.
So the health budget is how much?
Yes, but we're not going to take money out of
it. How much is the health budget?
It's 120 billion pounds.
And how much is what we spend on sport? What percentage is it?
I'm talking...
It's less than 3%, so it's about 3p in a pound. So I would spend, what we do spend, 3p in a pound. Okay, I think that's a good
And you think the proportions of medal sport versus grassroots sport are correct?
The value of?
The proportions that we spend on medal sport versus grassroots sport, you think are about right? You don't want to choose it. We should do both.
Well, it depends what you're looking for. So I think a lot of the conversation, DCMS have written this really forward-thinking. They're going to measure sport on all the things that we were talking about, mental health, physical health, community well-being, personal development, and local economy. So they're absolutely wanting to do that, and it's a revolution.
Yeah, it's new. It's not what we did in the run-up to the Olympics. No, it's a new strategy.
But we're all agreeing on that. We all think that's brilliant, right? That's fantastic.
It's better than it was, yes.
So that's great, and it's only a year old. That's a good, massive step forward.
It's also a recognition of failure. A recognition of having done the wrong strategy.
Well, we could have a positive view of it, which is good. It's a good thing.
I think it's a good thing. But Diane, on the choice point, I mean, you know, the 10-to-1 ratio is consistent with numbers we see in other sort of investments of money in sport. But we have to make a choice. But there aren't many uses of funds that have a 10-to-1 benefit ratio, right?
It's great, right?
HS2, for example, would be something I suspect those numbers aren't like that. So yes, we have to make a choice, but we can also be advocates for trying to change that choice as well. We shouldn't just take it as static today.
Absolutely, yes.
It's the impact of the spend. You could spend 70p and it'd be wasted.
Let Tanni
Sorry, come in sorry, Tanni.
No, I mean, the sports strategy, I think I'm right in saying, was the first sports strategy in 13 years, so it was kind of overdue in terms of what was needed. But if you look at the blocks of money between elite sport, if you look at what the PE spend is in a school, if you look at what a local authority spend is on leisure services, it actually starts being quite a big chunk of money, and the percentage of elite funding is a small part of the whole amount. What happens with sport is it's just segmented into lots and lots of different places. And I think if you put it together in a different way and we're smarter how we spent it, we get even more value for money out of the money. You know, you could, if you change teacher training right now, so this is, you know, a gross exaggeration and the worst case scenario of kids in a state school, but we now know that girls disengage with physical activity around the age of 8. They stay in sport until they're 13 because schools make them do it. They then become a primary school teacher, and most primary school teachers are women, and some of the good institutions give them 8 to 10 hours in how to deliver PE. If our children were being taught maths by someone who stopped doing it at the age of 8 and got 6 hours instruction how to deliver it, there would be uproar. But because it's PE and it's frivolous, and actually probably a lot of people our age, I mean, had a really miserable experience of PE in school. I did, because I wasn't any good at sport till I was 17. You know, we treat it differently. So there are things that we could do, which are not easy to do, but could have this big change. And actually would give kids from a state school background, you know, actually where I do agree, you know, the reason independent schools are really good because they're taught by trained PE teachers from the age of four. That's why some facilities in some independent schools are great, some are atrocious, but it's the quality, it's that contact that they have from the minute they start playing that's really good.
Thank you. Somebody else in the audience, hand up there, caught my eye. Towards the back, thank you.
Nicholas Hallen, Assembly Times. One thing just to back up Will, which I'll, before my question, which is, we're being told by the Speaker that you can't get money out of NHS budgets. You're kind enough to put one of my tweets up, but missed out the crucial bit. I linked to a piece we did, a colleague of mine did, in the paper last weekend, Sunday Times, showing that Newcastle had actually switched £1 million of public health budget into parks for exercise, recreation. That's great. What I was going to say, though, is we haven't heard about... if we're trying to measure things here, and we were talking earlier about participation. A few months ago, Brendan Foster told me that they could actually measure the spike in activity after the Great North Run and compare and contrast with Olympics or whatever other sport. But it strikes me that's a big gap in what's being talked about, because if you want to talk about diverting money from health budgets or just looking at take-up, I'd want to know more from the audience what we know from apps, there are many of them, Strava and all the rest of them, which would tell us what's successful in terms of take-up, and also at a time when insurance companies are now openly looking at how to rate people's risk if they do activity a bit more about.
That's very interesting. I'm going to gather up a few comments and questions, and then we'll come back to the panel for responses at the end. So one there, and then I'll move around the room. Thank you.
My name's Dennis O'Connor. I've got a couple of points to Mark. You've quoted the tax take from the Premier League, but as you know, a very large amount of Premier League income comes from us through our Sky Sport subscriptions and whether we attend and whether we buy the shirts or whatever. If we choose not to spend that money, which flows through down to the players, we're spending it in other parts of the economy. We're buying a new car, we're going to a theatre, we're going to restaurants. Right, yeah. So you've got a great displacement effect. The Premier League says this, look at all the tax we pay, but that money's only diverted from other parts of the economy. The second point I would make is you quoted statistics on how much the Premier League spends on community work and grassroots sport. Why did the Premier League clubs then oppose a government proposal to pay a fixed percentage of their TV money into grassroots sport?
OK. Let's save that one up as well for you, Mark. Okay. Anybody in the middle section of the room? So I can see two hands, one right behind you there, Roland, thank you.
Thank you. Baroness Gray Thompson touched on physical literacy very briefly, and for me this is, I think, personally the biggest issue, the fact that children don't actually have the skills to play sports. There's a big issue in terms of children not having the skills and therefore not having the confidence to play sports, so I was just wondering what the panellists' views of actually channeling funding to tackle the issue of physical literacy rather than facilities or other areas. So.
Thank you. And there was one in the middle with a sort of red jacket there. Keep waving so he can see you.
Hi there. My name is Will Parry. I did a PhD in exercise behaviour a couple of years ago. And I wonder what the panel thinks about this. We're talking about sport a lot of the time, and this is kind of the point that Tanni made earlier. Sport is generally a catch-all term, but there's a problem, especially when you're talking about children, that you do talk about traditional sports. And actually, most adults, when as people age, they tend not to play traditional sports. They tend to do what we call lifestyle activities. So these are things that you can fit into a busy life where you have a job and you have a family. So things such as jogging or swimming, yoga for women, or Zumba, or going to the gym, etc. So is there a bit of a tension in this kind of discussion where we talk about children and facilities and sports and organised sport in particular, when actually, when you're looking at an ageing population, you really need to encourage people to get off their bums at work, and also to be able to actively commute and also do those activities that are just individual, flexible, free, you can do whenever you have the time, essentially.
Okay, so there's quite a lot of points for the panel to respond to there. Tanni, let me start with you this time. That point about traditional sports, I think, is quite interesting. Nothing on earth is going to get me out playing team sports again at my age.
I think it's really hard because, you know, when I was in school, going to school in Wales, the boys played rugby and the girls played netball. And we were very lucky. Our state school had a swimming pool. No idea how, so we all swam. The world has changed since then in terms of just the huge number of sports are on offer. I look at the way my 15-year-old wants to consume sport or physical activity, and she doesn't want to go, you know, every Thursday night at 7:30 to the athletics club. Sometimes she wants to go somewhere. And we're in a hugely fortunate position that she has choice because we have money in terms of how she's able to participate. But I think we have to step outside the traditional sports. You look at things like skateboarding, which is going to be Olympic sport, parkour. You know, 20 years ago, would we have let our children jump over steps and off things? We'd have a heart attack. But now, actually, you know what? They need to learn risk. What we now know is children don't have the same understanding of risk because we lock them away and don't let them play out on the street. So I think there just has to be a much broader range on offer for people of any age. We also know from, again, your Sport England research, that the way they're looking at it now, people dip in and out. You know, depending what your kids are doing, you know, it's not as simple as if you're sporty, you play lots of sport, and if you're not sporty, you do nothing. And we have to be much smarter. And the data's going to just evolve and get better as it goes along. But much smarter at doing that. I live in the northeast of England, so I live, you know, about half an hour south of Sunderland, which is an area which is economically deprived, educationally struggling, there's no job. You know, there's massive challenges there. And if you're struggling to put food on the table, then you're not going to think about sport and physical activity. So, you know, we have to, you know, this room's a bit of a bubble. I live in a bubble in Westminster, I live in a bubble in London. And we have to remember that actually this is not the real world of a lot of people who want to participate.
Thank you. Mark, I think the sort of wider economic impact of the Premier League might be a bit outside our brief this evening, but what about this idea of a broader tax on Premier League revenues in some way?
Yeah, I think the clubs feel that they'll make decisions based on their resources to support various activity, and would argue that, you know, the benefits of what they do is already pretty high. So I think that's why they're not particularly keen to sign up for a tax. But I do think if you talk to the clubs, they are pretty committed to their communities. I know sort of a few, obviously, better than others, and Stoke is one, but the club, for example, claim, and I think they're right, their academy is bigger than it needs to be for Stoke's needs, and the reason is the club, and particularly the chairman, think that every kid in Stoke who has a chance of being a professional footballer, the club is there to give them the best possible opportunity of that. So there's a couple of players who haven't made it in Stoke who are playing in Scotland. So I can understand the appeal of a tax. I think the clubs are already committed, and I think voluntarily are already doing a lot on that.
Well, and Simon, I'd like you, between you, to take up this question about do we actually know what drives take-up? And maybe this interesting idea about getting the insurance companies involved, because they have all kinds of data on this.
Well, you need funding from somewhere, and clearly we're not going to get more from the government. But, I mean, I keep coming back to what Jerry Morris said. Well, for swimming, there needs to be a pool. And that seems to me the thing that we're skirting a bit here, that why are kids not physically literate? Why do they not know how to play sport? Well, because they've never played sport. Why have they never played sport? Because there is nowhere where they can play sport or be coached by somebody who can at least, not even coach them, just put them out there. And so, I mean, you know, I have three small children, so I watch this. If you give children a football, mostly they're pretty happy. If you give them a football and a place to play, most of the rest will follow. And the absence of that football, a place to play, and an adult watching them so that it's moderately safe, seems to me what we're not putting in Britain. And I am sure that, you know, as Tanni says, we are in a bubble. This is the NGO elite, which is, you know, anthropologically very interesting to see. I'm sure that between you, you are all smart enough and well-connected enough to make more of that happen. And really, you know, whether we win 40 medals in Tokyo or 20, I don't think is going to make the slightest bit of difference to that.
Brief response to that, Will?
I think there's one word that hasn't been used hardly at all, and it's quite astonishing, actually. You can have all the fields out there that you want, and you can have all the kids with a ball, but you need volunteers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And yeah. We've had a good hour. Now, I deliberately not mentioned volunteering because I ran a sports volunteering charity for 4 years, legacy of 2012. The Olympics created a fantastic volunteering legacy. Every single form of participation you're talking about is utterly, utterly propped up on them. The well-being of volunteering in sport is double that of playing. You get more sense of purpose, you meet more people, you get more connections, you increase in trust in your local community, you feel better about where you live. It's enormous. If you want to have a debate about something that's really tangible and meaningful, let's not have elite sport versus grassroots. Let's take all the money spent on sport and encourage more people to volunteer in it. To your point, anybody can do it, any age. You can go and help at parkrun if you're 90. You know, I was just listening to the whole thing. You can go back and back on different points, but it works for everybody. Every kid is going to benefit from it. Literacy in schools, fantastic. Let's see if there's ever an opportunity for people to volunteer doing that with the suitable DPS.
I don't think anybody's going to argue against volunteering. I want to squeeze in a couple from this side of the room, but it's going to have to be brief now because we're getting towards the end of the evening. So one right here, thank you.
I just wanted to ask on your last point about volunteering, how does that work in the inner city where it's really challenging for people without the social structure to get involved in volunteering?
That was nice and brief. One more from over the side. Right at the back. Right at the back. Thank you. Up here.
Very Oscar-like.
This is a part of the programme to give the people with the microphones plenty of exercise this evening.
Thanks. Just linking to the volunteering theme, I actually lead a charity that has elite sports people who volunteer to give back to other people. And I think the key thing here, I can't leave the room without talking about a lot of the stuff around elite sports role models. It's kind of, I feel like we've put it into a bit of a box here, that it's all to do with inspiration. 70% of the UK team came from non-private schools. And actually, they had a huge challenge to reach the medal that they'd got to. And they've actually able to give across a whole variety of attitudes to young people in this country. So it's not just to do with the physical activity, it's to do with resilience and determination and a whole range of other things that people can learn.
Thank you very much, a kind of uplifting comment. We're going to have to end it, but I want to ask, just on a show of hands, not what you think now about the original questions in the survey, but put your hand up if you've changed your mind compared with what you said earlier. Who's changed their minds? Thank you to the brave person who volunteered that he changed his mind. It's been a fantastic discussion, so I want to thank Simon Kuper for his provocative and, I thought, very inspiring speech, and to our very distinguished panellists for all their contribution this evening, to you and the audience as well. But please, a round of applause. And now, Julia Grant, Chief Executive of Pro Bono Economics, is going to finish up the evening for us. Thank you, Julia.
Thank you, Diane. So I'd just like to reiterate the thanks to all the people who've made this evening possible. To Centre Communications, you've really made this a live topic for us. Thank you very much. And our other media partners, Connect Sport and YouGov. And if there's any part of this evening you want to revisit, there's good news. Our partners Sea Change here are busy filming away, so we will have a clip of this evening up on our website in due course. Thanks again to Nomura for sponsoring us once again this year, and to Weill, welcome on board. So in a minute we're going to invite you to continue the conversation next door, but before I do that, may I just leave you with one thought. I think there's been a lot of agreement around the room this evening about the need for a new funding strategy for sport and a welcoming of the new DCMS strategy. My observation is strategies are one thing, but it's a long and winding road between strategy and execution. In this room tonight, we've heard from a few charities who are already doing fantastic work with young people to promote activity through sport, dance, exercise, and all manner of other activities. So let's, as we leave this room tonight, let's think how we can support that work and the support of people like us at Pro Bono Economics who are doing, helping them improve their value and their impact. They're making a difference now. They're making us fitter, stronger, and more confident individually and as a society. So for some of us, our way of contributing to a better world is to run a marathon. But sometimes it's enough to say, I'm in. Thank you very much.